So we're going to be in this series, Asking for a Friend, for about 5 weeks. And thank you, first off, for those of you who sent your questions in. Really appreciate all those questions. I will say this, there were so many that we're not going to be able to get to every single one of them. Some of them I answered kind of directly. But I will say this, at the last sermon in our series, I'm going to probably address several all at once, kind of rapid fire to answer some of the more some of the questions that can be answered a little bit more quickly. There were two, though, that were asked over and over that I want to address, and we're not going to necessarily preach in this series. Those two things were the book of Revelation, because you can't preach Revelation in 5 weeks. Okay, it's going to take a lot longer than that. I have that ready. We will do that at some point. I will preach through the book of Revelation. But the other was just sort of end times. You know, we're seeing what's happening in Israel, and some of your questioning is there something going on here? That's not something necessarily I want to preach from the stage. We could do that. It really fits better more in a classroom setting, just so we can have discussion about it, and you can ask your questions, follow-up questions. So those two topics we're not going to discuss, but we will, and so we'll let you know when those come as part of a series or come to a class. So today, what I want to do is just lay a foundation. That's really what we're doing today, a foundation for how do we approach these really difficult questions, because we need to know that. You can't just hear a question from a friend or maybe from a family member and then approach that in a way that's not healthy. Because if we do that, if we answer these questions in the wrong way, we're going to push people away from the church and away from Christ. So we can't do that. So today is all about laying a foundation for how do we answer all of these questions. So let's pray, and we'll get into some text here. Father, we come before you, always so thankful for your word. And even today, we may think that how could this word that you've given us speak to some of these questions in our culture today? And yet, there are some amazing things that you've put in your word, especially from your Old Testament, that show us exactly how we should go about this. And so I thank you for that, Lord. And I hope that you will allow us to hear this today, that we will take in exactly how it is we need to approach these difficult questions, apply that to our life so that we can interact with our family, our friends, anyone that we may come into contact with that may answer or may need an answer for some of these hard questions. So speak to me, Lord. Allow these to be your words. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. So where should a Christian land on the issue of immigration facing our nation? Can you be a gay Christian? Is it okay to live together before you get married? If I watch pornography and my spouse never finds out, is it really hurting anyone? Can a Christian drink alcohol? If so, how much? Can a Christian smoke marijuana recreationally in a place where it's legal? What do I say to a friend whose child is talking about being attracted to the same sex? Is same-sex marriage a sin if the couple loves Jesus? As a Christian, how do I handle a friend who is transitioning from a man to a woman or a woman to a man? Is homosexuality a sin? Is having sex before marriage really that big of a deal? Is flirting with someone adultery? Is abortion all that bad if I have it early enough? If I kill myself, will I still go to heaven? I feel depressed sometimes. What does the Bible really have to say about that? See, we all have these questions. Some of these are questions you asked. And typically what we do with questions like this is we sweep them under the rug. Oftentimes, that's what we do, whether that's in the church or maybe even in our families, because they're hard, they're difficult, and they're messy, and so we don't want to air out our dirty laundry. But in this series, we're going to tackle some of these questions, some of these issues head-on with the Bible as our moral compass, that lens by which we're going to see everything through. So today is just establishing a foundation for how do we approach our culture that is compromising. And hear me, church, the culture is shifting. There is no doubt about it. We see it happening all over the place. Whether we like it or not, the culture is shifting, and we're going to have to approach that in a particular way because of that. Recently, a New York farmer was fined $10,000 because he would not allow a same-sex marriage wedding to happen at his wedding venue. They fined him $10,000. They required him to go to sensitivity training. Now, for many of us, we've been hearing this for a while, but it's really the first time in our culture that something like this has happened, and we're kind of wondering, what do we do here? This is crazy. It seems like it's getting worse. And I want to tell you that this is not the first time the people of God have faced a culture of compromise. It is not the first time. The book of Daniel describes how the shifting culture of Babylon tried to force compromise onto the people of God. So King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, when he would besiege a city, he wouldn't just go in and annihilate everyone. He actually would go in and he would take the best of the best from that city and he would send them back to Babylon. He would send them back and essentially to brainwash them. Listen to how they did this. In Daniel chapter 1, verse 3, it says this: "Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, his chief staff, to bring to the palace some of the young men of Judah's royal family and other noble families who had been brought to Babylon as captives. Select only strong, healthy, and good-looking young men," he said. "Make sure they're well-versed in every branch of learning, are gifted with knowledge and good judgment, and are suited to serve in the royal palace. Train these young men in the language and literature of Babylon." What's the first thing they did? First thing they did is said, "That sacred book you have, get rid of it. Get rid of that sacred book. We're going to teach you a new literature. We've got some new truth for you to try to understand." And isn't that what happens? Isn't that what has happened in our culture? We take the Bible out of the schools, then we take the Bible out of the courtroom, and that way we can establish a different standard of morality. So they tried to brainwash Daniel and his buddies, first with Babylonian literature. That's not all, though. Next, they give him the best food and the best wine, and then they essentially want to train them for a total of 3 years. Daniel 1:5, it says, "The king assigned them a daily ration of food and wine from his own kitchen." So it's the best of the best. They were to be trained for 3 years, and then they would enter the royal service. It's not just new literature. Now we're giving them fine food and wine and Babylonian training for 3 years. What does that sound like in our culture today? College. Right? I mean, maybe not the fine food. Depends on the cafeteria that you're at, I suppose. At Ozark, I believe they were training us for the mission field, so we got some interesting food while we were at Ozark. But that's what it is, right? Essentially, he says, "We're going to send you to college." Maybe the food isn't as good, but for several young Christians who go off to a secular college, many times they're told to leave their faith behind. They're told to forget this. That you don't need this, that this is not truth. And yet, the Word of God has stood the test of time over and over again. The proof of its inerrancy is incredible. Nothing in all of literary history even comes close to the validity and the proof that we have of Scripture. But sadly, our universities say, just get rid of it. Now hear me, I'm not against sending your kids to college. You should definitely send your kids to college, but you need to understand you're sending them to a mission field. You need to understand that, and you need to prepare them and have them ready to defend their faith, because it will be a challenge, and not just in the classroom. Like Daniel, his buddies, that food, that drink, right? That's what we see happening in college. Life can sometimes offer an abundance of that food and drink. Sometimes that leads to trouble. In Babylon, it took them 3 years. Here, we've got too much, or now we have too much technology, so it takes 4 or 5 years to finish college. But the Babylonians try to change their literature, change their diet, their drink, and then they change their names. Daniel 1, 6 through 7 says, "Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were four of the young men chosen, all from the tribe of Judah. The chief of staff renamed them with these Babylonian names. Daniel was called Belshazzar. Hananiah was called Shadrach. Mishael was called Meshach. Azariah was called Abednego." And you may think, well, what's the big deal? I mean, They just renamed them. What's so wrong with that? Listen and look at what their names mean. Daniel's name means God is my judge. They changed his name to Belshazzar, which means Lady Protect the King. They gave him a girl's name. Now, if you go back through history, you look at all the cultures of the world, and what happens when that culture begins to implode and they begin to walk away from God, one of the first things that happens is gender confusion. And we see this happening in Babylon. They even changed Daniel's name to a girl's name. We're experiencing that here in America, aren't we? A lot of gender confusion happening like we've never seen before. Why? The culture is shifting. It's shifting. Hananiah, his name means Yahweh is gracious. They change his name to Shadrach, which means I am fearful of God. His whole life, Hananiah grew up with this name and the thought that God is gracious, God is merciful. His very name means that. And now they are trying to brainwash him into thinking that he can't trust God, that instead he should be fearful of God. Next is Mishael. His name means who is what God is. In other words, there's nobody like my God. Nobody. And they give him the name Meshach, which means I am despised and shameful before God. You see, one of the greatest tools that Satan has at his disposal is to try and trick you into thinking that what you did back here in your past is always going to define your present and your future. But that is not how God sees you. That is not the way he looks at you. What you did in your past has been forgiven. In your present, you are a new creation. In the future, you will be with him for eternity. But Satan tries to trick you by thinking that you should be shamed and despised by God. They even change his name to try and push him in a different direction. Last is Azariah. His name means Yahweh is my help. He would have learned his whole life, go to God when you need help. They rename him to Abednego, which means servant of Nebo. Nebo, or Nabu, was a Babylonian god. See, sometimes when you go to God and you ask for help and he doesn't answer the way that you want him to, you may go to some other god. Maybe you don't call it a god, but it becomes a god for you. So for Daniel, his buddies, the culture is shifting, so is ours. If there is any hope for a shifting culture to get back to God, it is only when the church begins to create its own culture that can somehow work against what we're seeing happening out in the world. Will you give into the culture that's shifting around you? There's a question you need to answer only for yourself. I can't answer it for you, and you have to live this out. It's not just a one-time thing. You don't just answer that question and then move on to the next. It is a lifestyle that you live. It is a way of waking up every day, spending the day with the Lord, and making sure that the people around you, the people you come into contact with, know that you are a follower of Christ. When we do that, culture changes here, and culture will change outside of here as well. I'm going to give you four ways that you can react to this shifting culture. Now, these are just some ways, they're not all the ways, but this is how Christians tend to react to our culture today. First, you can choose to conform to the culture. We can kind of begin to look like the culture around us. That's not what we want. Some of you may think that this or that change is conformity. Maybe you even think, well, we've changed music. Well, that's conformity. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. There are some new songs I love. There's some new songs maybe I don't love. But my worship, my belief in God and my worship is not founded on a song. Listen, I love to sing praises to him. That is only one way that we worship, church. Just one way. Worship is everything that you do, all the praise, all the glory. The way you live your life is worship to him. It is not just based solely on a song. And when we begin to conform to the culture, we begin to really change what we believe. We soften our stance to appease the shifting culture. We want to attract people to Jesus in a less offensive way. But that doesn't work. That's not truth. Because it's not supposed to always be easy. That's just not the case. The gospel is countercultural. It is offensive. And if the culture is going to react that way, we have to not conform to it. Joel Osteen, that very popular preacher, he was asked by Oprah Winfrey one time, several years ago, she said, "Do you believe that there's only one way to God?" And he answered, "Oprah, the Bible says the only way to God is through Jesus Christ." And I thought, all right, he got one right. But then he said, "However, I believe there are many ways to Jesus." Listen, some are going to conform. They're going to find clever ways to just sort of dilute the truth so that we don't offend anyone. But Paul tells us in Romans 12:2, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, right? But to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you're going to be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Conforming to the culture, that's not going to work. That does not help the cause of Christ. Don't go that direction. Instead, some choose to be combative towards the culture. That's a little bit more of an antagonistic approach. We're moving in the right direction because we're moving towards truth, but we're kind of missing the heart of Jesus. Peter had this issue that he had to work out there in the Garden of Gethsemane. Kind of an embarrassing thing for him, but he got combative. In Matthew 26, verse 50, it says, "Then the others grabbed Jesus and arrested him, but one of the men with Jesus pulled out a sword, struck the high priest's slave, slashing off his ear. 'Put away your sword,' Jesus told him. 'Those who use the sword will die by the sword. Don't you realize that I could ask my Father for thousands of angels to protect us and he would send them instantly? But if I did, how would the scriptures be fulfilled that describe what must happen now?" See, that combative approach, it just doesn't work. It sees the culture as an enemy. Guys, they're not our enemy. They are misguided people who need to be saved. They need to know who Jesus is. We're about helping more people more often say yes to God, right? It's incredibly hard to accomplish that mission in a combative way. We want to show our culture that Christ is true, that he does love, but that he will hold them accountable. And this combative approach typically pushes people away rather than brings them in. Now, there's others. They don't conform. They don't get combative. They just choose to check out of the culture. Don't get me wrong, we need to look different, we have to, but to completely secede from it and just distract ourselves to the point where we have no interaction with the world is not the way to go either. That is not going to work if we want to bring people to Christ. Jesus, in fact, prayed that we would not be taken out of the world, but that we would maintain our faith in the world, that we would be protected from Satan while we live in this world. Listen to what he says in John 17:14. Jesus says, "I've given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I don't belong to the world. I'm not saying you take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I'm sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth." We're going to talk about that word truth here in just a minute. But we can't check out of our culture, of the culture around us. Just because it's shifting doesn't mean that we check out of it. We actually have to lean into it. Jesus didn't check out of his culture. Right? He didn't check. He leaned into his culture. He went around people. He sat with people that we would even today go, "Man, I don't know, Jesus. You're going to go hang out with them?" Yeah. Why? Because they're lost. Because they need to know who I am. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news. That's what Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews, tells us. But how can the culture around us call on him to save them unless they believe? And how can the culture around us believe if they've never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? Right? We have to tell them. We can't check out. What does that mean? That means we must follow the example of Jesus and we counter the culture with grace and truth. It is in that tension, guys, between both grace and truth that we live. It's right there in the middle. That's where we live all the time. John chapter 1, verse 14, NIV, it says this about Jesus. "The Word became flesh, made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." John testifies concerning him. He cried out saying, "This was he whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." This is how we interact with a shifting culture. To a culture that just continues to compromise, we show them grace and truth. Jesus did this over and over again. One of the most well-known stories is John chapter 8, the woman caught in adultery. Right, the teachers, the religious leaders, they bring the woman to Jesus and say, hey, she's been caught in adultery, and your book, your law, says we should stone her. What do you say, Jesus? In John 8, 7, it says they kept demanding an answer, so he stood up again and said, all right, but let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone. And then he stooped down again, he wrote in the dust. When the accusers heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest, until only Jesus was left in the middle of the crowd with a woman. And then Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? No, Lord, she said. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. He showed the woman this perfect balance of grace and truth. Grace to not condemn her, but truth to say, stop it. Don't do this. We're going to go and sin no more. He said, I'm not going to condemn you, but you have to quit this life that you're living. It was that perfect tension. He showed her grace, but spoke truth to her. The problem that the church has had, that certain denominations even have today, or even Christians, as Christians we struggle with this, is letting that pendulum swing one way or the other, too far in either direction. And so we want to be a welcoming church, and so we let the pendulum swing all the way over here to grace, and then we whisper. Right? And then that doesn't work. That doesn't work because we're not living in the tension. But then the opposite is we swing all the way over here to truth and we just hammer and hammer and hammer the truth and there's no grace. And people don't receive it. And they go, why so much hate? And so it's in this tension, guys. We got to live in the tension. We have to speak the truth with the spirit of grace. I want you to remember that phrase. That's how we're going to approach every single question in this entire series. As Christians, we speak the truth with the spirit of grace. That is so important. We speak it, but that we do it in a way that is loving. At the end of 2 Timothy, Paul reminds Timothy that the culture is always going to shift. It just is. And you're going to have to learn how to deal with that and counter the culture with grace and truth. And he gives kind of some specific things that he wanted Timothy to do in order to accomplish this. So here's what he says, 2 Timothy 4:1. I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when he comes to set up his kingdom, preach the word of God. Be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not, patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They'll follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and chase after myths. First, Paul tells them, you need to be prepared to share the word. Guys, the time when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching has come. Okay, it is here. People today reject the truth and they chase after myths. But just because they reject the truth doesn't mean that we shouldn't share it with them in a way that has grace involved. We must be prepared, though, to share the truth of God's word, even when the time is not favorable, like right now. So in our shifting culture today, Christians who speak the truth, even in a spirit of grace, are oftentimes labeled as ignorant, intolerant, unloving. We're just going to have to deal with that, by the way. You're just going to have to deal with that. There's not really a way to change that. In fact, the book of Hosea tells us this is what happens when you share the truth of God's word, even with the spirit of grace. Hosea 9:7 says, the days of punishment are coming, the days of reckoning are at hand. Let Israel know this, because your sins are so many and your hostility so great, the prophet is considered a fool and the inspired man a maniac. Isn't that the label that we get sometimes? Right? It is, as Christians. That's sometimes, yes, we share the truth, you're just a bunch of fools. You're inspired maniacs. There's no love and grace in what you're saying. Let me ask you this. Let's say somebody is driving up an exit ramp, going the wrong direction, Okay? They're headed into oncoming traffic on I-25. What is the most loving thing you could do for a person heading up that exit ramp, headed for a fatal collision? Would it be to put their arm around them and say, you know, I just want to affirm you're a good driver? You don't do that, right? You wouldn't say, you know, I just want to encourage you today and tell you, your driving skills, your abilities behind the wheel, man, they are top notch. No, you say, hey, you're going the wrong direction, right? You're going to scream the truth. You're headed for a crash. You are headed for destruction. You're headed towards death. Don't go that way. The most loving thing you can do is to tell them the truth with a spirit of grace. Even though the time is not favorable right now, I know it's not favorable, we still have to shout the truth. We must be prepared to share the word so that perhaps we can help some people avoid that fatal collision. And maybe we begin to counter the culture by creating a culture of our own that brings people towards Jesus. Now, Paul continues to give Timothy the way that he can kind of counter the shifting culture. 2 Timothy 4:5, he says, but you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry God has given you. Paul tells Timothy, he tells us, don't be afraid to suffer for the good news. This is really important. It's not easy, but it's important that you hear this. You need to be willing to suffer for God. Persecution is on the rise. It's intensifying around the world. Some cases, it's intensifying even in our culture. The challenge for us, though, is to endure that, to endure the suffering. We don't cower under the culture. We don't cave in. We don't give in. We just speak the truth in a spirit of grace, and we stand on the word of God. And if we as a church stand on biblical truth, we are going to be attacked. You need to just be ready for that. But you can be, because our Savior was. He was scrutinized more than anyone else. Every single day, Jesus was attacked in some way. His opponents were relentless, always trying to trick him, always trying to get him in trouble. But Hebrews 12:3 says, think of all the hostility he endured from sinful people, then you won't become weary and give up. See, we have to think about what he has done for us, so that we can continue to move forward with the word of God, spreading the word of God, even if we have to suffer. When we look at him, we're not afraid to step out on faith. I'm going to say this really plainly so you can hear it. As we continue to move forward in this shifting culture, we are going to have to toughen up. We're just going to have to, church. You're going to have to get a little thicker skin so that when those attacks happen, you can say, you know what? I got to suffer for Jesus today. And that's okay. And maybe when people see you doing that, it will change their mind and they'll have a transformation and they'll come to Christ. We have to expect a little bit of that opposition, sometimes even from our own people, even from within the church. Because sometimes when you try to grow, right? When a kid grows, my kids are growing, they get aches and pains, right? Like it just kind of hurts. Your shoes don't fit, you know, after we bought them a month ago. You know, that's what happens, right? And it's painful in the growth. Guys, if we're going to grow, there's going to be a little bit of pain involved. And we need to be okay with that, suffering for the good news. Last way Paul mentions to Timothy that he can counter this shifting culture is to eagerly look forward to Christ's return. We got to look forward to that. That's really where we turn our eyes. When you get down and you're just not sure what to do, look forward to his return. Here's what Paul says to him, 2 Timothy 4:6. As for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. The time of my death is near. I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I've remained faithful. Now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on the day of his return. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing. We need to long for Christ's appearing because the world should begin to have less and less appeal to us. For Paul, as he wrote this letter, life is not real pleasant for him. He said, I'm already being poured out like a drink offering. That drink offering was meant to be poured out in honor to God, never to be used again. So Paul knows, I'm at the end of my life here, and I'm going to give everything I have. And he has given it all. He's been beaten. He's been shipwrecked. He's been imprisoned. He's been stoned. He's drained. He's poured out. He fought the good fight of grace and truth. He lived in that tension, doing battle against Satan for 3 decades. He knew his death was imminent. Paul longed for Christ to return. Are you eager for his return? None of you? I'm cool if he comes back today. Like, right now. I don't even have to preach the third service, okay? I hope you're eager for his return. And listen, I can't sugarcoat. I'm not trying to be pessimistic, but our culture is shifting. But I see some bright spots. I see places where the church is gaining back some of that ground, places where the church is creating a culture that people can relate to, can come and be a part of. There will still be people who want to hear only what their itching ears want. The question that you need to ask and answer for yourself is, are you going to let the culture change you, or are you willing to change the culture? Are you going to let the culture rename you, like the Babylonians tried to do to Daniel and his friends? Or will you stand on that biblical truth of who God says you are? When faced with a difficult question, a difficult circumstance, a difficult decision, will you prayerfully place yourself in that tension of grace and truth? Because Jesus not only came full of it, that's the way he lived his ministry. He countered the culture with that same grace and that same truth. He showed love to the sinner. He touched the leper. He sat with the outcast. He ate with the despised. But he also spoke the truth. He told them to go and sin no more. To wrestle with the issues facing our culture, we're going to need a measure of both those things. So when you speak the truth, even in the spirit of grace, some are going to see you as a fool. They may not say the word inspired maniac like Hosea, but it'll be something like that. But you can't compromise to that shifting culture. Bill Maher, if you know that name, know who he is. He's pretty famous for always putting Christians down. When he has Christians on his show, which he doesn't do often because he doesn't like them, number one, and he never gets anybody real intelligent, because then when that happens, he doesn't always win the battle of wits. But when he has a Christian on his show, he'll often turn to them and say, what does your imaginary Jesus say about that? Just so disrespectful. I remember when Tim Tebow kind of announced that he was going to remain celibate until marriage, Bill Maher said he was a homeschool nerd. There's going to come a day when even Bill Maher is going to have to get down on a knee. And he's going to have to confess to his Lord, whether he knew him as Lord or not, to confess to his Lord that Jesus is the Christ. We're all going to have to do that. And our mission is to get as many people as we possibly can to understand who he is, to say yes to him, and live their life for him. Guys, I don't know what the culture is going to look like in 25 years, but I know what our culture can look like in 25 years. I know what we can do, but in order to really create that culture, we have to speak the truth in a spirit of grace. And like Paul, just live eager for that day when he will come back. Until then, we counter our culture with a culture of our own, full of grace and truth. So this whole series is about asking for a friend. This is our foundation. We're going to approach every question with this same the same stance, grace and truth. But if this series is about asking for a friend, here's what I want you to do. Bring a friend. Okay? Right? It's asking for a friend. So next week, I expect there to be 1,000 more people here. Don't laugh at that. Why not? Why not? If you don't have a non-Christian friend, that's what you need to do this week. Okay? If you don't have a non-Christian friend to bring to church, start making one. There's lots of them. Okay? They probably live next to you. You probably work with them. You go to a restaurant and you're served by them. Okay? It's asking for a friend. So next week, if you have somebody in mind, invite a friend. If you don't have one, get one. They need to hear the truth. Okay? Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much that you have, even in your word, it's this wonderful book of Daniel that shows us what it's like to be kind of thrust into a culture that you didn't create, a culture that we're not supposed to be a part of, and yet we see Daniel and his buddies there learning to live in that culture, keeping their faith, keeping the truth that you've given them. We're so thankful that we can learn from them, thankful that we can learn from your son and how he interacted with his culture, with that spirit of grace and yet speaking truth. We want to do the same. And so as we approach these difficult questions, especially that last sermon, those many difficult questions, we want our friends to hear this. We want our acquaintances, our coworkers, those who don't know Christ to have some of their questions answered. And maybe we won't be answering one of their questions, but maybe they'll be willing to ask someone in this room that question. And so we just pray that you will really move in our hearts to just invite those who don't know you to be here so that we can be that light that we need to be in this community. We know that it's only through your power and through your Holy Spirit that we can make this difference. And so we yield to it fully and completely. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, to be people who can create a culture that begins to change the current culture we see. We know we can do that. Help us to speak the truth, the Spirit of grace. We love you, Lord. Pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys. Bring a friend next week.